La grazia e la pace alla del Signor Gesù Cristo. Grace and peace from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome to the Waldensian Presbyterian Church. Today is my beginning of my ninth year with you. I started November 1st, 2007, so it's also a joyous day for that for me as well. I want to add one member of the church who was left off of our departed saints of WPC. Back in January, Dorothy Rice died, and so she needs to be added to our list. We'll certainly lift her up verbally, but if you'll just pencil in Dorothy Rice's name, she is Judy Bowles' mother and died last January. Also, this morning, being All Saints Sunday, we will be remembering our church members who died in the previous year. And we also are receiving 5 cents a meal offering this morning, which supports the Presbyterian ministries of hunger and to impoverished people in our region. You'll note that there are two hymns that are inserts. And so inside your bulletin, the first hymn is Ye Watchers and Ye Holy Ones. Both of these hymns are familiar tunes, so we're not throwing you a curveball. They just happen to really tie in very well with the particular focus of this morning's worship. The second hymn was a rewrite of a hymn by Walter Stiles. Walter Stiles was a pastor of this church from 1951 to 59. He died in July at the age of 99, and I felt as I worshiped there that in Black Mountain, back in July, I thought, this hymn we need to sing on All Saints Sunday. So we are going to be doing that. It's on the back side of the other hymn that's in your bulletin. And then some other announcements. A personnel needs assessment survey. This is it in a printed form. It's also available on SurveyMonkey if you want to go online and fill it out there. We do need every member to respond to this and complete the survey. We have about 80 plus right now, and we'd love to have well over 100. That's our goal. So please take time. There are copies of this in the narthex if you'd like to get one on the way out. It takes about 10 minutes to fill out, and I think as you'll see these questions, it's asking the right questions to help give us a sense of where we're going in the life of this church over the next 10 or so years. The deadline for that form is this Friday. The Women's Thank Offering Dinner is 12 p.m. November 9th. That's a Monday week. And we'll be upstairs in Fellowship Hall, and all the women that are involved in Presbyterian circles are certainly encouraged to attend. This next week, you'll see Angel Tree and Christmas stocking item order forms available to assist with that, so be planning and preparing for that. And then our new officer training continues tomorrow at 2. Remember also, this is an election week in this community, and we've got some important issues and important positions to fill, and we encourage you all to go out and vote. Now, let us prepare our hearts for the worship of Almighty God.
Thank you. is in the name of the Lord.
Amen. Amen.
In life and in death,
we belong to God.
At the time of our baptisms, we were all baptized into Christ's death.
Through the proclamation of our faith, we know we live fully unto Him.
You who are redeemed by our loving Lord of the resurrection,
come, let us worship God in new life.
Let's pray. Eternal God, you have knit your people of all times and places into the one holy body of our Lord Jesus Christ. Grant us this day your Holy Spirit of encouragement and strength as we persevere the race set before us, until such time as we join the great cloud of witnesses who share with us in your glory. Keep us one with each other and at peace with all who share your gospel, until such time as we finish our own races and are greeted by you and the holy cloud of witnesses which surround you. Give us the compassion and the courage of our Lord, who remains the way, the truth, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Thank you.
truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, God, who is merciful and just, will forgive us our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. In confidence, then, in God's grace, let us pray together the prayer of confession. Eternal God, in every age you have raised up men and women to live and die in your faith. We confess this day that we often forget the privilege we have to be called your holy people. You call us to proclaim your name in our actions and in our words, but we are often fearful with our actions and silent in our words. You call us to do what is just, but we stand by and watch things unfold of their own instead. You call us to live faithfully, but we live in indifference instead. In your great mercy, forgive us and give us new eyes to see, new hearts to feel, and connect with our neighbors. Give us the courage to follow your path every day, that joined with those from ages past who have served you with faith, hope, and love, we may inherit the rich joy of the promised kingdom in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Take a moment of silent confession. Friends, a saying is sure and worthy of full acceptance that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, that we might be dead to sin and alive to all that is good. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel in Jesus Christ. We are all forgiven. Amen.
Found the place where this person was, and guess what happened? Any ideas? Very rare, rare, rare thing. Jesus said, "Lazarus, come out," after he had prayed. And guess what happened? Lazarus, who was dead, raised up, and he walked out in front of the people, and the people were all amazed. You think Lazarus ever forgot that moment after that? I bet he didn't, did he? Jesus loves his friends, and Jesus will respond whenever we ask for things in our lives. One of the things that we have to remember is to never forget whenever Jesus helps us. That's hard as we get older. Jesus is going to help you at some point. And as we move forward, we have to move forward in gratitude. Let's pray. Lord, we want to thank you for this story that reminds us of your love and of your concern. We want to thank you for your word that reminds us to walk as your people. We ask that for these children, even at this early age, they might begin understanding how to be your people, how to walk forward in gratitude. Amen.
Cancer, and he started his treatment this past week and has responded well to the first treatment. But we keep the Pritchards, particularly Mark, in our prayers, as this he has a 25% chance of survival at this point. Linda Brackett and John went down yesterday to Winston-Salem to be with her cousin, George Keck, who had a heart transplant in June of 2014. And is he still alive at this point?
He died this morning.
He died early this morning. We knew that he was very close. But we keep his wife, Helen Keck, in our prayers, as well as Linda and the family. Then also, Pam Pons had a cyst removed from her liver, and we keep her in our prayers. In a week from today, Melanie Grill will be 100 years old. She is the oldest living member of this church, and so we pray for Melanie today as we celebrate her 100 years in a week. And then Sam Jones, also the son of Earl and Wilma Jones, has been leading a delegation. They arrived yesterday to Israel and Palestine and are from the Atlanta area churches, and so keep Sam and that delegation in your prayers as things are in great tension and turmoil there in the Middle East. Also, we're going to be praying by name for those who have died this past year and particularly for their loved ones. So let us now turn to God in prayer. On this All Saints Sunday, O God, we lift before you our gratitude for the promises that you bring us in Jesus Christ. For he is the Lord of the resurrection. And this morning's worship service reminds us of that in many ways. Lord of the resurrection life, not only for those who die, but also for those of us who live each day, claim the power of resurrection as it impacts our daily routine. But this day, Lord, we start by lifting before you the 10 individuals in our church who have died this past year. We remember them in our hearts. We remember them with smiles on our faces of things that they have done to enrich our lives. We remember them with a sense of joy of their ministry and ways in which they served you faithfully. So we ask, Lord, that you fill us with a sense of peace, that they are now made whole with you and living with you eternally. We remember Anthony Stephen Martinot, Ruth Jones Manoose, Dorothy Rice, James Lee Hadley, James Hugh Fletcher, Charles Truett Cosby, Truett Herman Baird, Onesime Henry Jimmy Pons, Herbert N. Giroux, and Edward Pascal. For them, O Lord, the victory has been attained. For us, the sadness remains. We ask your comfort to be with their family members as they grieve their loss, as they reintegrate life without their presence, especially in the season of firsts, of Christmas and Thanksgiving, in times in which their loss will be felt even more so than today. Help us, O God, as people of faith, to always be pointing to the resurrection in our lives, that we may find confidence and comfort, strength and courage, as we live our lives by faith and not so much by sight. We pray, Lord, your blessing upon those who face cancer, and especially lift up Mark today. As he begins his chemotherapy, we pray, Lord, that you strengthen those odds and give him the gift of full life and abundant life, and your presence with him as he battles cancer. We pray your blessing upon those who have had surgery this past week, and remember Pam. We ask, God, that you also will be with those who struggle silently with the meaning of life, or struggle for a sense of direction, or any kind of malady that is within their souls or their spirits or their bodies. Renew us, O God, by your favor, for we are your people. We claim that promise that Christ is amongst us and that he has united us in your purpose and united us in love for each other, just as we share in his love for us. So we offer this prayer in the name of the one who taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
come to the reading of God's holy word, first let us turn to God in prayer. Open us anew, O Lord, to the power of your living word, in words that reflect upon the death of one man and the promise of resurrection which he attained. May we too be strengthened as we face death by the promise of resurrection, which is far greater. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. From John chapter 11, very familiar story, the story that we enter into midway through the story of the death and resurrection of Lazarus. Starting with verse 32. When Mary came where Jesus was and saw him, she knelt at his feet and said to him, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who came with her also weeping, he was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. He said, Where have you laid him? They said to him, Lord, come and see. Jesus began to weep. So the Jews said, See how he loved him. But some of them said, Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying? Then Jesus, again greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone was lying against it. Jesus said, Take away the stone. Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, Lord, already there is a stench because he has been dead 4 days. Jesus said to her, Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would also see the glory of God? So they took away the stone, and Jesus looked upward and said, Father, I thank you for having heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I have said this for the sake of the crowd standing here, so that they may believe that you sent me. When he said this, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come out! The dead man came out, his hand and his feet bound with strips of cloth, and his face wrapped in a cloth. Jesus said to them, Unbind him and let him go. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Thank you. was the darkest period for early Christians, around the start of the 3rd century AD, when Diocletian was the ruling emperor of Rome and the Roman Empire. It was a time when Christians were tortured and persecuted in the Circus Maximus as a venue of entertainment for the Roman masses. From 200 to 300 AD, it's estimated that around 20,000 Christians were persecuted and killed in Rome. One Christian woman in the early 200s was a wealthy woman named Cecilia. She was arrested and convicted because of her faith, even though she came from a very high standard or high level of involvement in the Roman system. She was in her early 20s, and she remained calm and peaceful throughout the sentencing. She proclaimed her faith in one God in three persons, and they sentenced her to death. As she died by having her throat cut, she signaled her faith with her hands. In the right hand, one God. In the left, three persons. Her body was found with that after her death, with those fingers remaining in place. Cecilia was a great inspiration for the church in those days and time when persecution was the order of the day. One God, three persons. What would allow a person who was facing death to be so focused, other than the power of the resurrection itself? Cecilia ended up becoming a revered saint within the Catholic Church, and by the 4th century AD, they had established in a catacomb, which I visited 2 weeks ago yesterday, beneath the earth about 60 feet, was a hollowed out area where a tribute was given to her, and there was a marble casting of her laying there as they found her with her fingers pointing. One God, three persons. It's All Saints Day. And we remember the saints of the martyrs. But we have a different orientation to sainthood than the Roman Catholic Church. In the Roman Church, Saint Anthony is the patron saint of folks who lose things. So if you lose something, you can pray to Saint Anthony to help you find it. There are all kinds of saints in the Catholic Church for all kinds of reasons. Saint George, the patron saint of courage in the face of battle. But we think of saints in a different way. We think of saints with a small s. What that means is that when we think of saints, we think of the people who are seated in the pews with us, as well as every member of Christ Church that has died to go on to be with God. So, saints around you, and yourself being a saint. A saint in progress, most certainly. I remember last spring when we had Hugh Fletcher's service, David stood right over there in the lectern and said, "My father was no saint." And there was a part of me that said, "Understood, but he was part of the saints of God's church." And so we think of saints in a different way than the Catholics do. Not as if it's some spiritual attainment of perfection that by our works we're able to attain this relationship with God that is somehow sanctimonious and filled in ways that the average person cannot attain. No. When we are baptized, we are given the gift of God's Holy Spirit. And from the day of our baptism on, we are becoming saints. It's part of our nature. So when we lift up the names of 10 individuals of this church who have died the previous year, we can, with every sense of confidence, claim them to be saints in Christ. To frame our understanding of sainthood, we have been blessed with this morning with the reading from the 11th chapter of John. And we find that Jesus is separated from Mary and Martha and Lazarus, and Mary and Martha send him a note that says, "He whom you love is ill." Now think about that. That implies a great degree of closeness. He whom you love, Jesus, as if without saying his name, they knew he knew exactly who it was. And why not? Because if you look in the book, the Gospels, you see repeated references to Mary and Martha, and occasional two different references to Lazarus, here being one. Whenever Jesus would go to Jerusalem, Bethany was about 3 miles away. And when he was in Jerusalem, he would stay at the house of Mary and Martha and Lazarus because he was very close friends with the three of them. Biblical scholars are pretty clear on this special relationship that Jesus had with those three. And we see it indicated in the language that they use in reference to Jesus. But it goes further than that, because after the death, Martha goes searching for Jesus and said, "Lord, if you had only been there, he wouldn't have died." Now, that's not the kind of thing you would say to a great and religious leader unless you had a close relationship with him. We also see that testified to in the way that Jesus responds, because when he hears and sees how Mary and Martha are so greatly distressed, he begins to weep. Shortest verse in all the scripture, Jesus wept. He weeps because of his recognition of their grief and his compassion for these two sisters. He also weeps because he too did love Lazarus as a very close friend. And in that dialogue, we see that Jesus responds to Martha and says to her, "Do you believe? If you believe and have faith, you will see what you have told you about the resurrection." And Martha affirms her belief in the resurrection. What we see here in this passage is a story where when Jesus calls forth Lazarus from this empty tomb, where there's a stone rolled away, we see some parallels there, intentional parallels that we should be alert to, because they're designed to be there to help us to understand just how much Jesus is Lord of the resurrection. Because being in an empty tomb, being in a tomb, and then having a stone that had to be rolled away are direct parallels that the gospel writer wants us to realize not only happened with Lazarus, but also very much with the story of the death and resurrection of Jesus. Here we have an encounter of the very one, the only one, who is the Lord of the resurrection with death. And you can't get much more dead than 4 days when there's obvious decay of the body. And Jesus calls him forth to come into life, and he does. Lord of the resurrection, the one and only who could do this thing after being dead for 4 days. This is the glory of God. On this day of remembering the saints of our church, we are invited by this story to claim that each and every one of the 10 members of this church who died in the previous year have now received the gift of resurrection life, who have been received by the Lord of the resurrection himself. It's not a matter, as we read in some lesser scripture passages, where you have to wait for the final trumpet to sound. We believe as Christians from the Gospels and from other places that this promise of resurrection life is something that happens at the moment of death, where the new seed, as Paul speaks of it, this new promise comes into fulfillment. And so Lazarus emerges from the tomb, but his hands are bound by a cloth, and his face is wrapped in a cloth. His feet are bound. And Jesus gives the command to them, unbind him from death, for he now lives again. But I believe very much so that this story of unbinding from death is not just a story about that impacts those who die. Think about it in your own lives. How are we bound by anger to where we cannot allow the past that happened that was so negative in our lives to let go of it? And we harbor that hatred and that anger so much that we destroy our sense of life. Or the one who's so filled with guilt for something done years ago, who cannot be released of it, that's being bound by death in this life. And there are so many other ways. Teenager that's ridiculed in her growing up years so much so that she is bound by a loss of sense of self because she doesn't think that who she is worthy. Another way of being bound by death in life. So how is it for you? I believe all of us struggle with the bonds that we wrap around our hands and our face and our feet to keep us from really, truly living a resurrection life. When I went off to Italy, I was in need of spiritual renewal. And I was recognizing as I got over there and began to do a lot more intentional work on my devotional life and my studies, that I had been bound by a sense of death in my life that was contorting and distorting my sense of ministry and my sense of vitality as a human being. And so I started the slow process over 3 months. I actually started it here in August. By the time 3 weeks ago, I realized I really feel refreshed and renewed, and that which bound me up in my spirit is no longer there. So it happens to all of us, folks. If we're honest with ourselves, there are those things which bind our lives and keep us from really living an abundant life, a joy-filled life, a promise of resurrection. So how do we get unbound when we find ourselves there? Barbara Brown Taylor, who was an excellent pastor and preacher, noted throughout this nation for her gifts and skills as a homiletician sermon writer, tells a story of a man that was in her congregation who confided in her that when he was a child, he had about 8 or 10 friends, and they went to a swimming hole on a regular basis. And for several times that they went, his friends would encourage him to go out, swing out on the rope swing, and drop into the river, as they all had done. Finally, he allowed himself to do it. He let go. This same man, who, by the time he was talking with Barbara Brown Taylor, was in his 80s, realized that many of his friends had already died. Those very boys who had gone out on that swing and dropped into the water and encouraged him to release and let go and enjoy life had now gone on to be with God. And he realized, here is another opportunity. I'm the last in the line. I need, when my time comes, to let go. So for me to have done the work that I did the past 3 months on my spiritual renewal, part of it, a huge part of it, was letting go of those messages inside that said, I've got to do this, I've got to be this, I've got to do, you know, I've got to perform in such a way. All of that has got to be let go of. How else do we experience resurrection life in this world unless we learn how to let go? Let go of all that stuff, the anger. Let go of the shame. Let go of, and turn it over to God and say, God, I have no idea, and I did this. I have no idea how to proceed from this moment forward, but I'm letting go. And I'm trusting in you to guide me. We have to do that when we die. We have to let go of this world. Some people do it much easier than others. And it's been my experience as I have been at many a deathbed, that the vast majority of us Presbyterians, when that time comes for us, we do that well. We let go. Because we trust in a God of love and grace who brings us resurrection, hope, and life in this world and the next. The Apostle Paul says, whether we live or we die, we go forth in our life as if we go forth to die. And when we die, we go forth in death as if we go forth to live. So whether living or dying, we are the Lord's. We let go. And we go in faith. May God bless us with the gift of resurrection life that our dear loved ones who have departed have already received, that we may live that life of resurrection hope in this world and in the next. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. So those who have died this past year, Anthony Martinot, Ruth Benouse, Dorothy Rice, Jim Hadley, Hugh Fletcher, Charles Cosby, Truett Baird, Jimmy Hines, Herb Guru, and Ed Pascal. You'll have in your bulletin an insert from the reflection from John Donne. Many of us are familiar with this, at least parts of it. But I find that the tolling of the bell, which is the last line, has been transformed for me by my understanding that that tolling also means resurrection life, not just death. So now listen. The church is Catholic, which means universal. So are all her actions. All that she does belongs to all. When she baptizes a child, that action concerns me, for that child is thereby connected to that body, which is my head too, and is engrafted in that body whereof I am a member. And when the church buries a person, that action concerns me. All of humanity is of one author, and is one volume. When a person dies, one chapter is not torn out of the book, but is translated into a better language, and every chapter must be translated. God employs several translators. Some pieces are translated by age, some by sickness, some by war, some by justice, but the Lord's hand is in every translation, and God's hand shall bind up all our scattered leaves again for that library where every book shall lie open to one another. As, therefore, the bell that rings to a sermon calls not upon the preacher only, but upon the whole congregation to come, so this bell calls us all. For no one is an island entirely itself, Everyone is a piece of the continent, a part of the main. If a clod be washed away by the sea, Europe is the less, as well as if a promontory were, as well as if a manor of thy friends or of thine own were. Everyone's death diminishes me, because I am involved in humankind, and therefore never sin to know for whom the bell tolls. It tolls for thee. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us affirm our faith together. If you'll stand, I've chosen for this day primarily words from the book of Job and also Ephesians. Oh, that my words were written down. Oh, that they were inscribed in a book. Oh, that with an iron pen and with lead they were engraved on a rock forever. For I know that my Redeemer lives, and at the last he will stand upon the earth. And after my skin has been thus destroyed, then in my flesh I shall see God, whom I shall see on my side, and my eyes shall behold and not another. My heart faints within me. There is one God and Father of us all, who is above all and through all and in all. Amen. Please be seated. Let us offer our gifts of love and gratitude to Almighty God.
Thank you.
day to learn again how to use that life and to celebrate it. Fill us, O God, with joy that we may go forth from here through these gifts and through our lives serving you faithfully, bringing hope and joy and peace to human life. We ask these things in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Of our risen Lord be and abide with each of us now and forever. Amen.